Welcome to Cliburn Masterpiece. I'm Buddy Bray, I'm your host for this series, and we come to you from the Kimball Art Museum in Fort Worth, Texas. Cliburn Masterpiece is a series in which we delve into some of the greatest masterworks ever written for solo piano, and we get the insights of some of our Cliburn laureates. A set of 24 short piano pieces, each in a different key. Each of them captures a different mood. Each of them captures a different piano technique. In this episode of Cliburn Masterpiece, we'll be talking about the Chopin Preludes, Opus 28. We'll hear a complete performance of them from the 2013 Van Cliburn International Piano Competition, and we'll get special insight from 2013 laureate Fei-Fei about practicing and performing these masterworks. Here's Fei-Fei.
What is a prelude? It's a musical term that we hear a lot, but it seems to mean different things to different people.
Yes. A prelude used to refer to something, a short piece of warm-up or exercise to be played, usually before something more important or more substantial. But the Chopin preludes are different. Chopin was the first composer to really elevate this genre to be played on its own, independently, no longer just mere exercises, but really of such high artistic values, each one of them.
Don't you think that's just true of just about everything Chopin wrote for the piano? He sort of took where the form was and elevated it a little bit. He was a key figure. You mentioned that Chopin is your most favorite composer to play. Why is that?
Yeah, I think Chopin, well, first of all, I grew up playing a lot of Chopin, and I think I did a competition, a Chopin competition in Asia Pacific area when I was 11. And I won all four categories back then. So I think that gave me my first a confidence boost. So I feel like, oh, I guess I can play Chopin. I think for me as a player, when I play different composers' music, I definitely feel like I'm encountering different personalities. And just like how we make friends in real life, there are just some people you get along easier and better. And Chopin was one of those composers for me. I felt very easy to relate to. For example, like Beethoven's music, it definitely takes me a lot of studies and to really grasp his personality. He's like fiery or passionate, that kind of, it's something that doesn't come completely natural to me. And I also feel with playing romantic repertoire, unlike, for example, Bach, in the Baroque period, composers had to write really strict counterpoints and there were so many rules. And I think the same kind of restraints also apply to the performers because we have to play within the style. We don't want to insert too much of ourselves in the piece. We don't want to step on the stylistic rules. But with Chopin's music, I think there's a lot of room and freedom for the player. We often say Chopin as a music poet, and I love poetry. I grew up reading a lot of, ancient poems and essays from like the Tang and Song dynasties. I feel like with poetry, there are usually so few words, but the meanings that those words carry are so infinite and profound. And I think that's the same with Chopin's music oftentimes. For example, like the prelude number two, it would be. So he only wrote very, very few notes, almost minimum notes, but I feel like the imagination or the feelings it can inspire are limitless. And that's what makes Chopin's music so profound and poetic.
The thing about most poetry is that, as you said, there are so few words, and they are so artfully arranged that a poem can mean different things to different people.
Yeah.
So, and that I think is often also the case with Chopin's piano music.
I heard Chopin's favorite composer was Bach, and before his concerts, he would play Bach's music to warm up. So this piece was inspired by Bach's Well-Tempered Clavier. Chopin also sets each one of the preludes in a different key, so completing a complete palette of 24 major and minors. So each one captures such a distinct mood. And I think when Chopin was writing this piece, he was on vacation in Mallorca, Spain, with George Sand. But it turned out to be a miserable vacation because it was winter time. Chopin was really sick. And then all the islanders were not welcoming to them because he was really sick. They were worried his sickness would be contagious. And also his relationship with George Sand was not going well. So it turned out to be a really dark time in his life. And all of his doctors were telling him that he was about to die. But it turned out to be one of the most productive times for Chopin to compose. So to me, I think this piece not only exploits all the tonal colors of 24 major and minors, but we get to hear a very vulnerable Chopin. So I feel like as a player, I get to be very close to Chopin's heart in this work.
He was certainly influenced by Bach, of course. And you can see that not only in the fact that he wrote 24 preludes and, you know, in a scheme in which every tonality would be represented, but also in texture and counterpoint. Mm-hmm. I think Chopin was very careful in the way he wrote counterpoint. He's not given that much credit for that.
Yeah.
Sometimes we tend to think of him as the man who wrote the pretty nocturnes and so forth, but he was meticulous and just on a compositional level. What has always struck me in playing Chopin and what makes Chopin kind of a scary composer to play for me is that even though he wrote a million notes sometimes for a pianist to play, every one of them is important. The texture is always sort of transparent in his music. So there's nothing out of place. There is nowhere to hide.
Chopin is definitely so texturally so imaginative with his writing. Each prelude's texture is so different. No note is extra. So I feel like in playing Chopin's music, like voicing is always so important because he does share that bel canto, like the operatic singing style, and with a lot of the textural notes around them. So I feel like we, as players, we get to explore so many colors or voicings and layerings in playing his music.
Do you think more about creating a whole big storyline over 24 pieces, or are you thinking about, okay, now I have this mood, and then I have this mood, and now I have this mood? How do you think about that in creating a performance?
I think playing through them as a whole set is a really an incredible journey, but it's something that takes some time to get used to, for sure. Because when we practice the preludes, we often practice one at a time and in depth. So putting them together, actually, it took me a few run-throughs on stage to feel the flow. And I also started to look for some subtle connections between the preludes to make me feel the flow or the connection a little bit better. Because the thing is, each prelude is so brief. The shortest one are only like 20 to 30 seconds, and the longest is only 4 to 5 minutes. And each one presents such a different technical challenge as well as emotion and character. So to shift so quickly, it was quite challenging for me. This piece definitely grows on you very much. So when I first learned, of course, it's the just like any piece, you learn the notes. But over time, I feel like when your hands or the technical athletic parts of this piece are taken care of, it just offers you so much room to be spontaneous and to be free to interpret. And even when I play this piece in different halls, in different acoustics with different audiences, I feel I get different inspiration and play it differently every time.
Yeah. Another, that goes back to what we were talking earlier about Chopin, the sort of, he can change with us. Can we talk about the technical challenges in the Preludes? Because I think if you haven't played the Preludes yourself, you don't think of them as being technically challenging like certain of the etudes are, but that is not true.
It's not only the technical perfection, but also creating the kind of character or the effects that he wants. With the number 14, well, I think it's one of the most treacherous preludes, and not only just playing note perfect would be difficult, but also I think Courtauld gave a set of poetic titles to each one of the preludes, as well as Hans von Bülow. And at the beginning stage of my learning this piece, I found those titles to be extremely helpful and inspiring. So I think Courtauld called number 16 Into the Abyss. So I'm imagining somebody riding the horse by a cliff. So it's like a very treacherous, very dangerous kind of a feeling. And the right hand is like this howling 16th notes, like the winds. And the left hand is this horse ride, the rhythm. So I think kind of combining these two together, so not only note perfect, but create the shape. Mm-hmm. And that I think is the most difficult. So even when I practice, I try to really practice with that shape in mind.
They're shapes instead of just da 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 da. The only time I've ever played the B flat minor was for a ballet, so I got off a little easier because they couldn't go as fast as the prelude actually is. Can we talk a little bit about the others, which might not seem on the face of them so technically challenging, like the E flat major, for instance? That's hard too.
I think it's even harder than number 16 for sure. That one is, I think the thing make it difficult is it needs to be very effortless and like feather, like very light. It cannot be very busy and heavy. So I think that makes it extra difficult because both hands are doing these contrary motions and with a lot of leaps, while you need to also sing a beautiful line on the top. So I think that's also very difficult. And there are some preludes that don't seem very difficult on paper, but are actually quite tricky, like number 5, this one. This one is also surprisingly quite tricky, I think.
Why is that one tricky? I agree with you, but explain it to us.
I think, when I learned the notes, I didn't realize it was tricky. But when I went on stage, maybe my muscles tensed up a little bit, I noticed, this is actually quite difficult. I think the reason is because the two hands, unlike number 19, the E flat major, are doing kind of this constant outward motion, a repeating motion. But in number 5, I think two hands, as if they each hand has an independent line. So they're doing kind of their own thing. It's, yes.
Can you show us that? It's great to talk about this kind of thing. Can you show us the difference? Can you play in slow motion a little bit of the E flat so we can see what your hands actually have to do?
So the number 19, the E flat major is. So this would be the slow practice. So each hands are going outward like this. And when. So we want to maintain a very light texture, but still have this line singing. So in the end. Whereas number 5, I think the hands are doing, each hand are doing different things. More intertwined texture, much more intricate
Sometimes, of course, you are called upon to play in a great big theater. The Cliburn, for instance, you were playing those Chopin preludes in a hall that seated 2,200 people. So how do you make intimate music? How do you make a big theater small?
I think from a technical standpoint, definitely just thinking about projecting sound differently than you would be in a practice room or a home. But other than that, I think I'm always trying to think of like this hall as my living room, almost thinking. So I think it's an experience of bringing the audience to you, I think closer to you, and by really committing to your music and really going deep into the music. I think that's because sometimes I think as pianists, we are very lucky. We don't have to stand like string players facing the audience. We get to face the audience with our profile. So when we look ahead or look up, we don't see anyone else but the instrument. So I feel like in that way, I don't feel distracted and I feel very focused and very together with the instrument and with the music.
Hey, thank you so much for joining us to talk about the Chopin Preludes today. It was one of my favorite performances of yours in the Cliburn, and you speak so lovingly about Chopin. And we're going to hear a complete performance now of the Chopin Preludes, Opus 28. Here is pianist Fei-Fei in the 2013 edition of the Van Cliburn International Piano Competition playing the complete Chopin Preludes.
Thank you.
putting all that careful practice into a brilliant performance. That's 2013 Cliburn Laureate Fei-Fei in a complete performance of the Chopin Preludes, which wraps up this edition of Cliburn Masterpiece. Thanks to Fei-Fei for visiting with us, and thanks as always to the Kimball Art Museum for hosting us in this endeavor. I'm Buddy Bray, I'm your host for this series. Thanks for watching.